confusion fades. Just a word, and suddenly I'm not afraid, 'cause you speak and freedom reigns. Let me listen to your melodies, the beauty falling from eternity. Pull me closer with your gravity, the weight of who you are, the weight of who you are. Let me wander in the mystery, and I will marvel at your majesty. Take me out beyond what I can see, the reaches of your love, the reaches of your love. There's something that can change it.
Praise God. Amen. Hope everyone's having a good morning this morning. Amen. Praise God. We have just a few more minutes for people to get back on here. Amen. Trust everyone's had a good weekend this morning. Can everybody hear me okay? All right. Praise God. Well, then let's go ahead and get started this morning. Let's ask God to help us. Amen. Father, we come before you. Lord, we plead the blood of Jesus upon this time. Father, I pray that you would help us. God, that you would move upon us, Lord. We pray that you'd speak to us through your word. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Praise God. First Timothy chapter number 6. We're going to begin in verse number 20 and 21. 1 Timothy 6, 20 through 21. So we've been looking at the last several weeks or the last month of divine deposits. And this is trusted with truth. And so the New Testament, it is The New Testament words commit or committed has the idea of things entrusted or deposited for safekeeping, not violation nor to commit sin with. And so we're going to look at some things God has entrusted to believers this morning. And one of those is being entrusted with ministry. Through trusted with truth. All right, so let's look this morning first off at straying from the truth. The foundation of the modern church has very much shifted and what churches are built on. 1 Timothy chapter number 6, beginning in verse number 20, the Bible says, O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. By professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. So let's look at the foundation this morning. The church today has been built upon the felt needs. It is the emphasis is on what a person feels or what they want. You have church marketing, the surveys of what do you want? What do you want from a church? And it'll become everything that you want. Literally, it'll become everything that you want. The program orientated, a program catering from every possible demographic in a congregation. the young, the old, the single, the divorced, the left-handed, the right-handed, the ugly, the good-looking. You know, shopping for a church, they have different programs and different things. One church, they have an indoor archery. And yes, you heard me right. They have an indoor archery ministry. Some, they go as far as even having bowling alleys. And so what they're trying to do is they're trying to meet felt needs. The other foundation of the modern church have shifted, and what they're built on is experiences. The ultimate reality for many is a feeling that they have experienced. You know, it's the idea of the ambiance. You've heard me say this before, you know. The lights get dim. The smoke machine comes on just enough, create a nice little haze. The lights turn on the stage, and out comes the pastor. El pastor, you know. The songs that are sung all about the individual rather than God, about how they feel. People begin to cry. People begin to weep. And they create this atmosphere, the ambiance. And many times churches are built on this, is how it felt. You know, worship, modern worship, music, is deliberately trying to create a wow feeling, an amazing feeling, a sad feeling, a happy feeling. You remember the song back in the day? Yes, Lord, yes, Lord, yes, yes, Lord. You know, 2 Peter chapter number 2, verse number 2, and many shall follow their pernicious, which is sensual or sense-based ways, by reason of which the way of truth shall be evil spoken of. Charisma Magazine reporting on a service where all people were laughing. There is no doubt that they were having vast numbers of listeners convulsing in laughter to make them, whatever it is said in the public, irrelevant. And so you've got these people, man. You got these churches that all of a sudden they begin to do these insane things to create an experience. Look at 2 Thessalonians 2:9. Even him whose coming is after the working of Satan with all power and signs of lying wonders. The third thing we see are the cultural expectations. Things go in and out of fashion in cultures. You know, you've got the dress, the morals, marriage, being exclusive, homosexuality. Some believe that the church should take their cues from society around them. You know, they ask the questions, what do you like? Well, you know, I like a little bit soft music. Oh, yeah, so do we. So do we. What don't you want said? Oh, we don't want that said either. Fuller Theological Seminary has sanctioned an LGBT group called One Table. Openly gay seminary, Mr. Piclesio struggled to get his conservative Pentecostal parents to accept him as a gay evangelical Christian for nearly a decade before his family found a common ground through faith. It quickly became apparent to me that I was going to be okay and that I wasn't going to have to forsake my faith for my sexuality. Mr. Biclasio said in his struggle for acceptance. You know, this is the problem for today. Is we, modern Christianity, downplays the importance of doctrine. See, doctrine means instruction or information about God. The sediment is that it doesn't matter what we believe. Doctrine is unimportant or even divisive. And sincerity is most valued. You know, as long as you're sincere, that trumps everything else. This is the mindset of the modern Christianity. You know, as long as you just love Jesus. You know, that's all that really matters. And doctrine is just so dividing, divisive. Those who do care about doctrine are attacked or even viewed as suspicious. You're so dogmatic. You're a fundamentalist. You're narrow-minded. And you shouldn't judge. And you shouldn't be so judgmental. At my church, you can just come however you want to. Man, why don't you come over here where everybody is accepted? Well, you know what? God does accept everyone. God will take you the way you are. But you know what? He's not going to leave you that way. And if the church stays with that, if modern Christianity continues to buy into the arena of sincerity over doctrine, it's in worse trouble than it's already in. Our scripture warns us of the dangers of doctrine. Doctrine determines action. 1 Timothy chapter number 6 and verse number 21. Which some professing have erred concerning the faith. You know, this word err is deviant or to miss the mark. This is a direction word because you will wind up in a different place. Look at 1 John chapter number 4, beginning in verse number 6. We are of God. He who knows God hears us. He who is not of God does not hear us. But this we know, the spirit of truth and the spirit of error. This word error means to move away, to stray, to be deluded. This is a supernatural dimension, error. Christians, churches, movements that have become completely different because of doctrinal error. There are movements and churches, organizations today that embrace things like homosexuality. They embrace this to where ministers in the church are openly gay. And you know what? They didn't start that way. They didn't start with that mindset. They actually started on a very straight path. But because of doctrinal error, listen, it moves you away slowly from correct doctrine. That if you begin to go any other path than this, there's no way that you can end with the fullness of the gospel. So let's look at avoiding the profane. False doctrine is dangerous. It has the ability to transform us. Look at 2 Timothy chapter number 2. 2 Timothy chapter number 2, beginning in verse number 16. But shun profane and idle babblings, for they will increase to more ungodliness, and their message will spread like cancer. Hymenaeus and Fatilius are of this sort, who have strayed concerning the truth, saying that the resurrection is already past, and they overthrow the faith of some. You know, Paul gives an obvious solution. He says, avoid that which can cause you harm. Avoid it. You know, there was a man many years ago who decided that wrestling crocodiles wasn't enough. So he goes into the ocean and he gets killed by a stingray. You know, you shouldn't be, there's certain things that you should not be playing with. There's things that you shouldn't be getting close to. You know, people who have pet tigers and pet lions, man, you are asking for trouble. There are things that you know you shouldn't be messing with. Don't mess with them, because if you do, at some point, you're going to be off. And when people backslide, it's not surprising to find out that in their recent past that they've been doing other things. You know, people just don't, from one day to the next, say, you know what, bag it. I'm just throwing it all out. Forget it. No. This is progressive. And it started with they were messing with something dangerous. False doctrine is dangerous. 1 Timothy 6:20, O Timothy, guard what is committed to your trust, avoiding the profane and idle babblings and contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. Some people think their whole life needs to be spent learning error. I've had people ask me, Pastor, what do you think about me learning more about Catholicism, or learning more about Buddhism, or learning more about Mormonism, or whatever? I think it's a horrible idea. Horrible idea. Because what you're doing is you're filling your mind with things that are dangerous. You know, it's important to avoid people of error, teachings of error, churches of error. You can't emphasize this enough today, that there are people that are dangerous. You know, first time I really saw this firsthand, I was on staff in Gallup. And I remember a man coming in and starting to talk to me about God and Jesus, and then he started asking me questions about the Holy Spirit and about the Trinity. And so I remember going to my pastor and saying, "Pastor, hey, this guy was asking me these questions." He looked at me and he said, "Nick, that man is dangerous. This is why, because this is what he believes." Da, 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 da. And he laid it out what this man believed, and then he showed me in the scripture of what the scripture says and how it's opposite from what he said. And so when I went back to this gentleman, I asked him, because it was in my own mind, I said, "Hey, let me ask you a question. Do you believe this?" And I began to, he said, "Absolutely, absolutely." And it dawned on me that my pastor saw this from afar off. He'd never even met the guy, and he just knew just from the few questions that I was asking. And I went back and I asked my pastor later on, "How did you know?" And he said, "Because I've dealt with dangerous people like this." Listen, there are people that are dangerous with false doctrine. Churches, teachings. Acts 19:9. "But when divers were hardened and believed not, but spake evil of what of that way before the multitude, he departed from them and separated the disciples, disputing daily in the school of one, Tyrannus." So some aspects of avoiding that Paul mentions. Number one is the profane. The profane is the outside the temple. This is the allowing beliefs to be determined by godless people. Professors, scientists, atheists. See, those who oppose truth, the Apostle Paul tells Timothy in chapter 6, verse 1 of 1 Timothy, "O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust." He says, avoiding the profane and the babblings and the contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. Atheists. Those who argue against truth. Either by false teaching or diminishing scripture. A survey of students who professed atheism, the internet factored heavily into their conversations to atheism. When our participants were asked to cite the key influences in their conversation to atheism, people, books, seminars, etc., were spoken. We expected to hear frequent references to the names like New Atheists. We did not. Not once. Instead, we heard a vague reference to videos they had watched on YouTube or even website forums. You know, it is critical to avoid the profane. It is critical to see danger when it arrives. Sometimes danger looks so sweet. Sometimes it looks so appealing. You know, even nature teaches us this lesson. You know, you have these bright, colorful frogs in nature. And they're colorful for a reason. Because predators will come and they'll eat them and then they'll die. Literally, they'll die from the secretion of the frog and the poison that comes from it. But they're colorful and they're attractive. You know what? Sometimes, danger dresses up in high heels. Sometimes it wears a tank top. Sometimes it wears a hat of knowledge, the Bible says. Sometimes it wears the coat of being popular or powerful, of influence. You see, this morning, the apostle says, avoid the profane. Which brings us lastly, thirdly, to guarding the truth. So Paul gives Timothy the correct understanding of truth. Because we have been entrusted with truth. Look at verse 20. O Timothy, guard what was committed to your trust. Avoiding the profane and the idle babblings and the contradictions of what is falsely called knowledge. You know, there is a trust. A trust in the faith, in the truth that is being spoken. This is not of human opinion or preference. What is given to us is inspired by the Holy Spirit this morning. Psalms 138:2 says, I will worship toward your holy temple and praise your name for your loving kindness and your truth. For you have magnified your word above all your name. The Bible is God's self-revelation. Who he is, what he has done, and what he requires. Barna Research says most self-identified Christians are comfortable with the idea that the Bible and the sacred books from the non-Christian religions all teach the same truths and principles. You know, not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, is going to enter into heaven. And not every book that you read about Christianity, about the Bible, even commentaries in some cases, are right doctrine. And it is important for us to understand this. That though someone may seem smarter when it comes to the book smarts and when it comes to the knowledge, listen, this is God's word, and this trumps everything. You know, this begins with teaching truth as something valuable and precious. You know, it will determine our entire lives, and ultimately, it'll determine your eternal destiny. 1 John 2:28 says, and now, little children, abide in him, that when he appears, we may have confidence in not being ashamed before him at his coming. The next thing to look at when he says commit or deposit, God expects us to still have truth over time. It's sad when a Christian gets saved, they've learned what the Word of God says, they begin to do that, and then through time and maturity, they become worse Christians. They become more carnal. They become more in love with the world than with God. And they cloak it under the umbrella of knowledge. God expects us to grow in his word. God expects us for this word to be deposited in us and for us to keep it unchanging, unadulterated, pure, as it was meant to be. You know, call me old-fashioned, but, you know, when I take $20 and I deposit it into the bank, into my bank account, if I go and ask for that $20 back, by golly, I better get that $20 back. Because that's what I deposited. And you know, God deposits truth in us. God deposits his word into us. And I don't know if he's getting his $20 back. I think for some, I think he's only getting $18 back because they left a little bit out because it didn't fit their lifestyle. Some, I think God's only getting 15, maybe even $10 back because it didn't fit. It just wasn't very comfortable. See, this is an active dimension. That we must do things to guard the truth. So I want to ask you a question this morning, and I hope to get some response. But what are some things that we can do to guard truth? As you're responding, I'm going to read Jude 1:3. Beloved, while I was very diligent to write to you concerning the common salvation, I found it necessary to write you exhorting you to contend earnestly for the faith which was once for all delivered to the saints. So what are some areas how we can contend and that we can fight for? All right, Jerry Benavides says being accountable. That is one that absolutely helps. And that we open up our heart to somebody that we trust is not in false doctrine. And so that is very true. That is very real for some people. All right, Josh Barraza, biblical knowledge. All right, so let's break that down to a very practical, is reading God's word. Okay, discipleship. David Barraza, learning to value truth by acting on it because it was purchased with a high price. Absolutely. But what are some things? All right, so reading our Bible daily and studying. Marianne, very good. What are some other ways that we can guard the truth? Walking in obedience to the things of God, okay? There's some very fundamental things that we have to look at. What are some things that we contend for and we fight for, that we struggle for? How do we do this? We have reading. We hold on to who we hang out with, all right? So that's the influence. Fellowship, all right? Prayer, conviction, witnessing. All right, keeping a right heart. I know that there's a little bit of a delay here. Prayer, daily prayer, very good. All right, so let's just look at these very quickly. Let's look at one, reading God's word. You know, this came up a number of times here in the comments, and so reading God's word, that is essential. How do you know what the Bible says if you don't know what the Bible says? if you don't read to know what the Bible says, then what the Bible says is only what other people say. Does that make sense? I hope it does, because it does for me. So, the next thing we look at is studying God's word, Acts 17:11. These are more fair-minded than those of Thessalonica, and that they receive the word with all readiness and search the scripture daily to find out whether these things were so. Did you hear what that said? That they searched the scriptures daily. Daily. So we have reading, and then we have studying. You know, studying God's word is not meant just for pastor. It's meant for every believer. Digging into God's word. The third thing we see is believing God's word. Believing that this is truth. That I can stake my life after this. You know, some people, they don't stake their life after this. Some people, they think, well, it works for you, but it doesn't for me. Listen, this is a universal truth. And you can, if you will stake your life after what the Word of God says, listen, it radically changes your surroundings. But this takes believing God's word. Okay, somebody, Josh earlier had said witnessing. I want to take this a step further. Preaching God's word. 2 Timothy 4:2, preach the word. Be ready in season, out of season. Convince, rebuke, exhort. With all long suffering and teaching. We are called to preach God's word to people. We may not all become preachers standing behind the pulpit, but we're called to preach God's word to people. You know, there's something that's pretty real for a lot of parents right now, but it's teaching. You know, a lot of parents are at home teaching their children about school and different things of this nature. But when you teach something, you're grabbing a hold of it. You can't teach something that you don't know. And so when you begin to teach God's word, even to the most simple-minded children, they come up with the greatest questions that can cause a person to have to think and go and look up. First Timothy 4:11, these things command and teach. And the last thing to look at, somebody had put up there, who was it? I'm looking up there. Jesse Benavides, being obedient to the things of God, to the things of God. Listen, obeying God's word at all cost. You know, obeying God is going to cost you something. It doesn't come cheap. For some people, literally, family will turn their back on them. For some people, it means possibly taking a lesser job. For some people, it means laying down their life. John 8:31, then Jesus said to those Jews which believed on him, if ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. He says, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. There's a lot of people who talk the talk, but they don't walk the walk. They like the idea of wearing the coat of a Christian. There's some people who love coming to church simply for the social aspect. And those people today that aren't able to come to church because of the social aspect, they find themselves drawn to the world now. They're drawn to ungodly relationships. You see, because it's a heart condition. And when we begin to obey God, it costs us things. And sometimes, even obeying God, we enter into an arena of even being lonely for a season. Finding ourselves in a position where, you know what? This isn't a popular decision. You may lose friends, or what you thought were your friends. But listen, if you are obeying God, God says, you are indeed my disciple. This releases something inside of our lives and our church when we do this. 1 Timothy 6:21, by professing it, some have strayed concerning the faith. Grace be with you. Amen. You know, if we will hold on to what God has deposited, if we will hold on to the things that God has entrusted us with, God can take our lives and do amazing things with it. I want to open it up very briefly for any questions this morning you may have concerning this. This is all we have. Amen. For trusted with truth, lesson number 5. So if there are any questions, now would be the time to input here in the comment bar. The comment bar is for questions. Anybody have any questions that you would like to ask pertaining to this? While I'm waiting, can you give me some water? What's the difference between doctrine and dogma? Well, I don't know the definition, Webster's definition of dogma. I can say that a doctrine, as we looked at from the very beginning, is the teaching of... see, dogma, I know I've got, everybody has a dictionary at their fingertips. I genuinely don't know the full definition of dogma, Sammy. You're going to have to look that up. I will, I'll get back to you on that, I promise. But I don't know. How do you allow God to deposit more in life by being obedient in the small things? So, it goes back to what we were talking about during the Serious Men. I think somebody asked the question, Jerry Fuentes had asked the question about the stewards, you know, and the steward and what he had given to the workers. And I believe that your question is one of principle. The principle of he who is faithful in the small things will be faithful in the larger things. And so if we want God to deposit more, then we absolutely need to be faithful in the small things. And so, yes, these are the smaller things of importance. It's a noun, it's a principle or set of principles laid down by the authority. Tractably true. Okay, well, there's your definition. Sammy, I'll look this up and I'll read up on this and I'll get back to you on that. But David, yes, absolutely. It's the small things in life of faithfulness. And then we continue to be faithful in those small things and God begins to bless us with more. And so, yes. That's a good question. Any other questions before service starts? Anybody else? Going once. All right, Josh, what is a good way to study the Bible? So when you're talking about doctrine, I've got a book that talks about the different doctrines of the Bible by Van Cleve. And, you know, there's a lot of different in the doctrine of the Word of God, there's set beliefs to a study. And so what happens is when you begin to look into God's Word, you'll see things that pop out. And so the best way that I have found to study God's Word is to take a word that sticks out, like salvation, the doctrine of salvation, and look up every scripture that you could find using the word salvation. The doctrine of atonement, the doctrine of healing, the doctrine of angels, the doctrine of sin. You know, and you begin to look at these principles throughout God's Word, and the best way I have found is you take that word and you begin to look up that word and what does the Bible say about that word, and you'll begin to find some real truths pop out. Anymore, we have access to world knowledge with devices, and we can figure out things in a heartbeat. And so, that's how I have found the best way to get a lot more pointed things with doctrine is finding a word that I'm wanting to look up, like salvation. And begin to study that word. And what does the entire Bible say about salvation? Jesse Rios, a belief or system of beliefs accepted as authoritative by some group or school. So I'm assuming that he's talking about dogma at this point. Which in that description and Linda's description, you know, you can see the error of dogma. Just because a group of people say that this is good, that doesn't mean it's good, right? And so just because somebody of authority says this is right, when it comes to the Word of God, that it doesn't necessarily mean that that's right, because it must be what the Bible says. And so, yeah, very good. Amen. Well, I think that's all we have for this morning. Amen. It is, I got 10:23. Service begins in about 7 minutes. Amen. The Lord bless you. We're going to have a great service this morning. Amen. Stay tuned. They released a video for tonight that won't be available till tonight for the Children's Church. I got to see parts of that. Amen. It's going to be exciting stuff all the way around for the kids and for our regular service tonight. Lesson number 5 with Missing the Point. And so stay tuned. The Lord bless you and have a great and